Il tutto, allora, quindi per questa, ecco Adnan, per questo secondo incontro ho invitato un paio di persone che sono qui con noi, c'è Gianluca Licausi e Marco Casolino. Gianluca è un fisico, anche lui di Roma, tutti e due sono di Roma. Diciamo dell'INAF, quindi Istituto Nazionale di Astrofisica, e cura un podcast che si chiama Physicast. Ora proprio ci racconterà un po' la storia. Marco Casolino, pure un fisico, metà tra Frascati, no, Tor Vergata e Giappone, poi dopo si presenterà lui. E anche lui collabora a un podcast parecchio famoso, si chiama Scientificast, e poi anche fantascientifica, sta qui, io non ho mai guardato perché anche il mio tempo pure è limitato. Credo che mantenga anche lui dei canali YouTube. Insomma, quindi l'idea è: voi andate avanti, provate a scarabocchiare sulla Jamboard, insomma, cercate di farvi venire fuori delle idee. Sì, then I repeat also in English. Cercate di farvi venire fuori delle idee. Possibilmente un gruppo in inglese in modo che anche Adnan possa partecipare. So, English, you have these links, Jamboard, you can use the Jamboard link to post it in order to propose idea or join other ideas so that you can form a certain number of groups. Remember, less than 10 groups. The idea is to, within these groups, from now to in 2 weeks, the idea is to either produce something. Clearly, not we do not pretend it is a complete and released product, or to evaluate something. I mean, compare YouTube channels, YouTube videos, TED links, or articles, presentation. Whatever you want, clearly in the field of science communication, in order to put into evidence the good and bad points about this product of science communication. Today we shall show you some testimonial. About in particular audio podcast. So we shall have Physicast, which is a podcast about physics in Italian by Gianluca Licausi, and Scientificast, and maybe Fanta Scientificast, which is a science fiction podcast with Marco Casolino. And then if we have time, Giovanna and myself, we shall show you other example of what we are able to do. Okay, so that's all. Let's go. I think I let Gianluca speak before first because he has to leave us at a certain point. So, Gianluca, if you can hear us, you can introduce yourself and and tell us how you designed, how you run Physicast, what Physicast is, and so on. My Gianluca is not here, or let me see, participant. Gianluca. Okay, if Gianluca is not here. No, I don't see him now. Maybe Marco, you can start.
Okay, so I will do it in Roman English. You know, let me
share this. We hear a lot of noise.
Wait, is it better like this?
Yes. Even worse.
But this noise was not mine.
Okay.
Is it okay now?
Okay.
Okay, so let me share the screen and I'm ready. So I'm sorry that the slides are written in Italian, but I will translate them in English. So the idea, first of all, I thank Franco for giving us, I speak on behalf of Scientificast and all these guys, the errors as usual are mine. So I thank Franco for the opportunity to talk about our experiences with podcast and outreach experiences in science, for science, with science, of science, whatever you want. And actually the bottom line is, these are just our experiences. If you want to do this sort of things, do what you want and be yourself, and this is the only thing that that you really need. In outside this outreach context, my work and research is in cosmic ray astrophysics and radiation environment in low Earth orbit and space. We built a number of detectors on, first of all, the old Mir space station to study the radiation environment and interaction with the ice of the astronauts, several balloon flights from USA, Canada, and New Zealand, and then a free flyer satellite, the largest of which was Pamela, an antimatter spectrometer devoted to the study of antimatter component in cosmic rays. Most recently, on the International Space Station, we have two detectors now that have been launched with Luca Parmitano last year. One is for the radiation environment. Actually, this is Paolo Nespoli in a previous configuration of this this very sophisticated dosimeter and cosmic ray spectrometer, and one which is in use is a telescope which makes a picture. Actually, this, again, this is an outreach video on YouTube done by the Russian astronauts that of Energia that do an excellent job in shooting, and not only because it's our video, but in general they have a Twitter account that are very, very social, which is funny for what is a former Soviet Union account. So in addition to this, some of these technologies over the years was also transferred to another kind of outreach, which is the technological transfer. In this case was applying the detector technology to building detectors that were usable by non-specialists for the assessment of radiation in food in Japan after the Fukushima accident. So this is in a few words what we are doing in, I will not call it serious, but in a non-outreach context. Our work in the outreach context is, the main one is Scientificast. It is a podcast of science. It is in Italian because basically the audience is Italian. Most of them do not speak English to the level, also us, but let's say the audience does not speak English to the level that they could have fruitful interaction in English. And plus, there are a huge amount of podcasts in English, so it makes no sense. It is in Italian, it's written in Italian. Many foreigners use it also as the podcast as an exercise to learn real Italian and the technical language. So anyway, this is the web page. There are both blogs and a weekly podcast. You can download it or listen to Spreaker, do what you want. And this is the website. This was, it's almost 10 years old. Actually, the first incarnation was even older than 10 years. Since 2012, it was Paolo Bianchi and Simone Angioni and another bunch of people, and I joined later on. And the web page itself more or less reaches 1 million, and the podcast is 1 million listeners per year. It's more or less 20,000 people listen to each episode. So the idea is to be informal, we do not take ourselves very seriously, which is the most important thing also in this context. We do not give wrong things, so it must be precise, but informal. So you explain how things are, but in a non-formal environment with a non-formal interaction with people, but you cannot simplify too much. And of course, the borderline where it's too much is, of course, depends on each person, on each style, and as I said, everyone does it works. It is interesting that in this case, the context is of a group of listeners which grows, sometimes declines, but usually is in a constant growth, but there are less statistical fluctuation or random fluctuation, whereas the blogs have more fluctuations. Sometimes, not recently, but we reached up also the third place in the iTunes ranking, the iTunes ranking is completely random and who cares? I mean, all these metrics of social metric, interaction metric, these are completely ridiculous. Actually, if it was in Italian, I would use a stronger, bad word, but let's say it's ridiculous. Don't care, use just as a secondary metric and a proxy to understand whether people like what you're doing. But the game and the trick of these social networks is that they want to lure you with a kind of metric which is self-assessed, and then you follow the Instagram follower or the YouTube follower and don't care about that. Use it as a metric to understand what you're doing and if you're doing things correctly. We also write several posts on the blog. This more or less is of the order of 500,000 per year. The idea is that they are put on a drive document and they must be seen by at least another person who is not of the same field. So if I write in physics, like how a lamp works or how to heat water and so on, a non-physicist must review and understand if it is understandable. So it's very useful to understand if it is understandable. And also the usual text revision that, as many of you know, it's also lacking from the very famous daily newspaper online. The printed version is much better, but the online error checking is non-existent. The photos usually are either ours or from Shutterstock, which is, we don't pay the license. They give us for free, otherwise we would never use it. For instance, this is a Shutterstock picture, this is my picture, and I think this is also Shutterstock. Or we can, in this, if you write this, do these things, you must be very careful to respect the authorship of the, who did the picture or wrote the text or whatever. So take them from Wikipedia or from, in a legal way, because there is no reason not to respect the ownership, and mostly you can always be sued for nothing. So it's meaningless. Then again, we use a WordPress environment. It is very careful to the search engine optimization, readability. I mean, these are all things that in principle would make no sense. They help a little bit in creating a more understandable text, but again, it should not be the metric on which you base what you write and what you do, because who cares? I mean, the bottom line is, again, you might need to have fun in explaining what you're doing in science or whatever you like about, but don't be put in the metric. Some other, so Spigoni is, as Franco knows, I'm a big fan of Boris, and if you if you speak English and you want to learn Roman, not even Italian, you should try to watch this series. So this is the explanation. So sometimes we have this like big poster, centerfold poster of, in this case, about energy. So we try to explain what is the context and so on. Sometimes they have a lot of success. Sometimes no one cares. But again, this does not matter. We tend to have less. So sbufalate is, bufala is a buffalo. And bufala in Italian means fake news, but bufala is much more fun than fake news. So S is a negative, so you want to unbunk the news. We tend to do a little, not so much of this. This is, for instance, the one on the word drive that actually you mentioned in the mail that Hubert made, but this is a really a complete scam about these guys who sell the work drive. So sometimes you write this, but we tend to have more emphasis to how things really are, because the unmasking fake news, and there are a lot of excellent web pages, podcasts, and so on, it requires a huge effort, because basically the proof must follow on the unbunker. Like Mad Bunker, for instance. So you need to explain why is this. And it takes a lot of effort, and it requires more logical passages in the listener. So you must say, this thing is not like this. So the listener must first listen to the fake news, then must listen why it's not the fake news, and then must listen what is the real thing. So sometimes it's even three passages. And then maybe if you are just a casual listener that like has an attention span like everyone of 15 seconds on Facebook, then you don't understand which is true and which is fake, and it's very complicated. So we tend just to say how things are and don't do the unbanking or the sbufalare. the group of people is of the order of 10 persons. This is a few years ago. They come from different backgrounds of science and technology. There is a strong zoccolo duro, a strong pillar from Genoa, because of historical reasons, but they come from all over Italy. Many physicists, but many biologists, chemistry, everything. Some teach in school, some are engineers, some are were students, and so on. So it's a lot of fun to interact with different people, and there are periodical calls for new. Of course, you earn nothing, you do it for free, for the glory, as they say when they ask you something for free. So every 2 years, more or less, there is an opening. You write a text, and if you want to write for scientificas and so on. This is actually extremely successful. We have like of people who pass the selection, 60-70% really write and work. Some get lost over the few months, but in general, a lot of new entries came from this call, and it's a lot of fun. About the podcast, it lasts more or less an hour. There are two persons who are on the episode. There is a Google Drive document that you fill and you say when you're available, and then a guy more or less says when you have to speak. The structure is you can listen, but there is an intro with a summary, the first topic, then there is an external, usually is an external interview of other two people to change a little bit the voice and the what you're saying, a second talk, then some comments, and then you close and the next series. So it's been ongoing more or less every week, except sometimes on Sunday we jump one episode, but more or less is of the order of 50 episodes per year. The other fun thing is that it's extremely difficult to understand, again, who cares, whether a post will have success or will have more statistics in people who read it. There is a fake news on the homepage, of course, but then there is a fake news on banking, which actually is in the opposite direction of what I said, about Mars being as large as the moon, and this is of the order of 200,000 news. Then there is something that I wrote like in half an hour, and it was extremely successful. It was actually a short story about making fun of people who think that the love equation is Dirac equation, because all the love is entangled, and since we interacted one with the other, and they, you know, that make tattoos of the Dirac equation wrong on their arms and so on. So this was very successful, and sometimes it takes a lot of a short time, and it becomes not viral, but popular. Some other times you spend a lot of time to explain things and no one cares. Actually, it was fun because this was copied many times, also by former, by other former physicists and also physicist colleagues that don't even check who was the author. They don't ask, I mean, it's not that you ask for money, but at least ask as many other people did. So the other bottom line is always, especially for physicists, this should be in your DNA. Quote the bibliography, the image, the text, and whatever, because it's the proper way of working it. And then anyway, when you write a paper, you have to quote the bibliography. In general, the whole thing follows, as everything else, a power law. So this is a normalized power law for 2015. And this is the number of views versus number of art. So this number of articles versus number of views. So you have a few articles, one single article that had like 100,000 views, and most of them have of the order of 100 of views. And there is no way, as with the masterpiece, you never know if you're going to write Harry Potter. That's why editors publish a lot of nonsense, because they hope that but you are random. It's also like Netflix, no? You have a House of Cards, but you never know that House of Cards or Stranger Things will be Stranger Things, or it will be like other terrible drama. So you write this post, you write for your own fun, and sometimes you find that some of them go outside the distribution. Then the other fun is fantascientifica, so science fiction scientificas. It was a spin-off again by Paolo Bianchi and Omar Serafini, and on science fiction. So there is a lot of historical science fiction, modern, there is a lot of emphasis on Japan. In general, the audience is 10% of scientificas. There is an overlap in the two groups, but they are also very separate. There are different people who care about different things. And it's another way of vehiculating the science the science message in a different way. In general, the podcast does of the order of 2,000 visits, 2,000 listening, and we tend to write less and speak more. Then other context is INFN outreach. These are the official things, so they do on Instagram. Instagram for me is too young. I'm sorry, I'm too old. We had a very successful this physical fantastic physics and where to find it, mimicking the Rowling book. I did a 15 seconds talk on Instagram, which again was successful, but 15 seconds in my way of doing things is too short to say anything, just like the spot. It almost looks like if you're doing a political spot, 15 seconds and then it's lost. So it was very well done and very successful, but not my taste. I speak much more, as you are noticing. Then I have a YouTube channel. It's again very small, of the order of a few hundred people. It is a lot of fun because we have this live. Actually, Franco was so kind to join us in the last Friday's live. And Friday evening, there are people who join to our lives and listen and interact a lot. And the live of YouTube, again, we speak about science and mix it with science fiction in order to make a less hard context. And so we speak about black holes, Tesla coils, relativity, and so on. And people interact much more. So since it's live, they make questions, you show the question online. It's a nice way of interacting with people and sometimes understanding that you are making things too complicated or too simple or too boring. So you get a lot of very nice feedback of what you are doing. And the mixture science fiction on jumping back and forth helps a lot in speaking for an hour with an audience that is not necessarily technically minded, and you correct the Hollywood errors and so on. Then I started actually doing the blog after Fukushima because I worked a lot with Japan and I was going there after the accident of Fukushima. So there is a lot of posts on radiation and so on. And I've seen how even people who are against nuclear at a certain level, but journalists of a given level, even though they are against nuclear, whatever, if you show the measurement, you show with a Geiger counter, you make the measurement, really in the Popperian sense that you falsify the fake news, you go together, we went together in Fukushima with some of the journalists, you show that the importance of the direct measurement and touching your own. So this is actually a few pictures of the disaster of Fukushima, but I think we can skip about this. What was interesting is that this is an operator of the food for kindergarten student, and they were using this kind of detector with the gamma spectrometer. This, you can see that here is the cesium peak because they wanted to be sure that there was no cesium in the food for children. Now the region is a lot of, is starting again, but it was a very, very long period. So I was starting to writing about this context in 2011, and the whole thing developed in after context. In a different context. And again, this was the importance of the measurement, different Geiger counters. Actually, you're not supposed to measure it on the floor, it should be 1 meter. But again, you show really, this is the measurement, these are the data, and there is no government trying to make a fool of you, even though sometimes it is like this. And this is, as I said, as part, not outreach, but this is a technological transfer, but this again is a transferring the science and the technology you are developing for your own research to a more general public to be useful for a wider group of people. Then there are the books. Again, you will never make money with books. I hope so. A former student of mine, she's a very famous fantasy writer, and she keeps writing books, but it's the only exception. Write book also if you want to have fun. They allow you to express the contents in much more detailed and calm way. It's less immediate and usable. I mean, if you want to vehiculate a certain message of a certain fake news or a certain context, something which is a piece of news, writing a book, even if it's an instant book like we did for the radioactivity, it takes a lot of time. And then no longer you should be bound with the editor, although they help a lot and they do a lot of things. There is, of course, the self-publishing for the Amazon. So you can do a little bit what you want also in this case. If you start doing these things, it's fun if you don't care too much, because you start learning about the metrics of this single channel, and you should try to not to be dependent on a single channel. There are like people who do only the Facebook Live. For instance, Facebook changed a lot of the algorithm, and now the post of science and so on, in general post, unless you do advertisement, are not visualizing, but subscribe to the post. YouTube changed policy for advertisement for kids and so on, and for people who did this for a living, it was a real problem. So they also try to distance from the dependence from the direct metric. Our main amount of links come from Google search, so you should try to do this. Instagram, as I said, I don't understand. and then again, the interaction of the public. Then as a last slide, I want to mention, all of this was mentioned yesterday, that what is called the third mission. So in addition to teaching and doing research, the Ministry of Research and University says that you have to do the third mission, which is doing the outreach. And for instance, this is an INFN slide, which shows that third mission, you get 10 points if you want to get a permanent position as an entry-level researcher, but also for internal progression. This, in principle, is very good. Really, I think it's terrible, because, again, you should do the outreach if you have fun. If you are like Sheldon in Big Bang Theory, you are incapable of doing that, you should not do it, because you should do research, you should teach, you should do what you have to want. Being forced to do this, I think it's completely wrong. But again, but keep in mind that this is a parameter for the metric if you want to get a permanent position. So if you are doing PhD and so on, you should do at least something that you can claim that is done. And then since it's Italy, you know, the commission will have to be creative as much as you have been creative in your CV when they assign the points. And I think that's everything. So if you have a question, I thank you anyway for your time.
Marco, ti sei dimenticato un punto fondamentale di Scientific Health.
Che sarebbe?
La barza brutta.
Ah, sì, no, l'ho tolto. So there is also the joke. There is the crucial point of Scientific Health is the very terrible joke, because we cannot do good joke, otherwise we would be a much more successful comic, and this is the barza of actually Simone, no? Sometimes it's terrible, sometimes it's awful. Yes, people tune in just for that.
Okay, thank you, Marco. Clearly, Marco, I think it can remain a bit. So if you have questions,
sure.
You can ask, you can write in the chat. And while you think to possible questions, I invite you to start proposing ideas in the Jamboard or in the chat.
For the moment, is white without nothing.
And I would so let me know if there are questions now, otherwise I would invite Gianluca Licausi to present another approach to scientific communication, which is in some sense similar but from a different origin. Okay, so Gianluca.
Yes, thank you, Franco. Okay, so I start sharing my screen, so tell me if all is okay. Okay, do you see my slides?
Yes.
I am Gianluca Licausi of the National Institute of Astrophysics. And I'm here because I've been invited by Franco to explain what is Physicast, the podcast of physics. That is a project born 8 years ago with the idea of explaining physics to people. And so Physicast is an audio podcast in which the researchers explain the physics with the simple language of simple everyday language. This is a screenshot of our web homepage as it is today. And the format of Physicast is a monthly exit and they are audio podcast of 15 to 25 minutes long in form of interview or dialogue or monologue even sometime. And they are, and some music is mounted in the underground in order to have a more pleasant listening. And the content, the argument of this podcast are all the arguments of the physics. We explain mainly the concept of physics, but also the phenomena of nature and the life of scientists and the technology of common use, developing of the physics in general. The style of Physicast is particular in the sense that we do not want to just tell the physics, but our challenge is to explain physics to people. Which of course is a challenge and is what makes this Physicast very interesting, both for us that create it and for the audience. We always try to use a simple exposition and to use a common language and always refer to the intuitive perception that people have about the world, about the intuitive physics. And in order to do this, we rely on a written text that will be read by the author. Okay, this is our format that I will explain it in much detail. So far we have published 66 episodes and our statistics tell us that we should have around 20,000 listening per month. The main reason that pushed us to develop this Physicast 8 years ago has been to give some hints to people to reflect to think about the world that is around us. And in order to stimulate scientific thinking, scientific mentality, and interesting on the research that is not so spread in our society. And our goal, our challenge in every episode is to try to switch on a fire that makes the audience think about their true reasons of things. Of course, we already have many different. Way of making outreach of physics and science. Of course, so that we can ask why to introduce a new one. Physics is does not want to replace any of these other outreach projects, but it is complementary to them. In fact, our, of course, we are we want all the people to listen us, but of course we are our public is principal the people that are already interested in science, that are already listening and watching outreach films and podcasts, and so that they already know what are the different reality of physics, the different aspects of physics in the world, but they want to understand them better, to understand them in more deep. And this is what in physics we try to do. Of course, the fact that we are an audio only podcast is a challenge both for us, because it's more difficult for the researcher to explain with just words what you want to explain without any graphic. But it is this is an advantage, because we as researchers are forced to find the right way to speak. And from the audience, it is also an advantage, because they are forced to think to what they are listening. So it's a bit more active than simply watching a documentary in TV. Then physics is also used in the high school for where teachers wants to make some to go deep inside some arguments of physics without using mathematics. And also it is very useful for the professionals who use physics in their work without knowing to use it. For example, medicine, biologists, architecture, and so on, so that they could better understand the basis principle that are in the background of their own work. Physics is made by researchers of the world of university and of research. And we are based on the support of the Associazione Frascati Scienza. The various, physics is not a course of physics. All our episodes are self-sustained and does not follow a scheme. But for any episode, we write all the text, and the text is refereed more times. Both the first time it is refereed by us, we has a scientific referee in order to make sure not to tell bullshit, of course. And then we also have we also make it read by a tester reader, which is some people that is not very clever in physics, but maybe clever in other in other activities, and in order to test the understanding. And then, of course, there is the registration and editing and so on. As you can see, we span in across all the field of physics, from classic physics to quantum physics, astronomy, and relativity, and so on. And by making very much attention to the common meaning of the word and using the word in their common meaning, not in the jargon meaning, and trying to find the best analogies to explain the concept of physics, we have seen that in fact it's possible to explain anything in the field of physics. It is really possible to explain and to make the audience understand the relativity, the quantum mechanics, and so on. And this is a very great satisfaction for us. Okay, I've prepared two pieces extracted from two episodes. Yeah. And of course they are in Italian, so I excuse me with the non-Italian audience. In this first episode, that is What is Space, we can listen to the initial part of the episode. While in this other, il vuoto means vacuum. We explain about the vacuum, and we can listen here just a piece in the middle of the episode. Scusate, sentite? Ah, quindi non sentite l'audio che io mando da qui.
Te lo senti?
Sì, io lo sento, ma quindi no, voi non lo sentite. Suggerimenti su come si può fare, se no...
Non so, perché probabilmente l'output va solo alle tue cuffie e non va... qui. Prova a levare le cuffie, forse si sente...
Prova. Il microfono. Prova.
Quello interminabile di un...
Sentite? Lungo.
Ma che cos'è lo spazio? Lo chiediamo a Gianluca Licausi, ricercatore dell'Istituto Nazionale di Astrofisica. Che cos'è lo spazio? Possiamo dire che sia il contenitore di tutte le cose?
Sì e no. Sin dall'infanzia impariamo tutti a percepire lo spazio come ciò che ci separa da un oggetto. Questo giocattolo posso toccarlo, però laggiù no, per farlo. Questa esperienza crea nella nostra mente la rappresentazione dello spazio, che tu dici, quella del contenitore. Questo modo di vedere lo spazio è largamente condiviso, anche perché si adatta molto bene alla realtà quotidiana. Tuttavia, nell'ultimo secolo, la fisica ci ha mostrato un po' dello
spazio. Avanti anche poi i volumi, perché si sente molto basso.
I filosofi.
No, torna indietro.
Non credo che riuscire.
Nell'ultimo secolo, la fisica.
No.
Cosa che si torna interrogati per sempre su cosa sia lo spazio. In particolare, famosa la disputa è venuta nell'Aidens nel XIX secolo. Lo spazio ha un'esistenza concreta e indipendente dalla presenza umana. Se di questa percezione ci viene a parlare. Ad esempio, se vi dico di pensare a un universo con
sente molto male, sai.
Ma uno spazio concreto esistente.
Vabbè, Franco, mi pare di capire che non si sente più, perché apparentemente voi sentite l'audio dalle casse,
sì, che viene dal
microfono, che poi viene ripreso dal...
Se vuoi posso fare un pezzo io. Forse se si sente meglio. Quale vuoi fare? il vuoto. Vabbè,
non fa nulla. Poi, insomma, diciamo che...
Ecco, un pezzo del vuoto, se vuoi, ce l'ho qua. Vediamo se, se si sente. Oh.
Ma credo sia...
Sente?
Sì.
Fisicast, curiosità dalla fisica, per comprendere perché accade ciò che accade. Ecco Giovanni, mettiamoci in questa auletta per preparare la prossima puntata di Fisicast. È vuota.
Beh, vuota non direi.
Come sarebbe? Non c'è nessuno. Ah, ho capito, ci sono i banchi, la cattedra, la lavagna, ma ha tolto l'arredamento, il resto è vuoto.
Niente affatto, quest'aula è piena d'aria.
Ecco, lo sapevo, in effetti lo so, ma non ci ho pensato.
E guarda che non è nemmeno poca. Considera che l'aria che riempie quest'aula ha un peso approssimativo di quasi 120 kg. Sapendo questo, possiamo valutare anche quante molecole di aria ci sono. Considerato che l'aria è composta per lo più di azoto mescolato a un po' di ossigeno, possiamo stimare il numero di molecole presenti che è dell'ordine di quasi 10 alla 22 molecole per centimetro cubo, o se preferisci 10 alla 28 per metro cubo.
Non ho capito, che significa?
È che il numero di molecole di aria che stanno in un centimetro cubo si scrive come un 1 seguito da 22 zeri.
Wow!
O se preferisci 10.000 miliardi di miliardi. Corrispondentemente, in ogni metro cubo ci sono un numero di molecole che si scrive come un 1 seguito da 28 zeri.
Urca, però sono certa che ci sono dei posti che al contrario sono vuoti davvero. Se aspirassi tutta l'aria in un contenitore con una siringa o con qualche attrezzo del genere, potrei fare il vuoto. Per esempio, ci sono i cibi sottovuoto, perfino certi materassi te li vendono sottovuoto.
Beh, insomma, non proprio. Le confezioni che chiamiamo sottovuoto in realtà non lo sono affatto. È vero che gran parte dell'aria è stata rimossa, ma ne rimane pur sempre una parte non proprio piccola.
Vabbè, penso che basti per dare un'idea.
Sì, esattamente, per dare un'idea. Allora, l'importante, vabbè, sorry, I continue in English, so the important is to know where to listen to Fisicast. It is published on many channels, in particular on Spotify, on the web, on Google Podcasts, then also YouTube. And then, of course, we have a Facebook page in order to be in touch with us and so on. Also, in the by means of the web page that I showed before, the auditors can write us questions and we reply. And okay, so so I just can wish to I just can to suggest to everybody to listen to us, especially to all of us that are not following physica planning the university, but other topics. And so have a good listen, and thanks to everybody.
Okay, so thank you, Gianluca, thank you, Marco. Now it is a bit up to you. I leave you for 10 minutes so that we can just relax a bit.
Maybe someone wants to ask something to our speakers who are closed the session. So if you have a question, you can just write in the chat or tell us directly, and because after our break, I think that the expert need to go. So
yes, I see that Nastasia is proposing, for instance, to do a podcast on the Jamboard. So please join or suggest, discuss, self-organize, And okay, so we are here. If you want to ask something, please do it now. So
otherwise, we can just
we shall meet again in 10 minutes.
And thank you so much to Gianluca and Marco. Thank you so much.
Thanks to you.
That, your expertise are so useful for our students. So thank you again.
Grazie a voi.
We meet with the students and the others in 10 minutes, Franco, about...
Yes.
10 minutes from now, okay? Thank you so much. Grazie Gianluca e Marco, grazie mille. E a presto.
Ciao, dimmi. Ma di quale file parli? No, quella l'ho scritta io. Tornano, per nessuno ha messo mano a niente.
Eletta, penso stiamo sentendo tutti la tua telefonata.
Yeah.